You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web and your number one source for after-show entertainment. Very good, Gene
from Los Angeles, California, and Maria Menounos, and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies, this is AfterBuzz TV Spotlight On. Spotlight On is a long-form interview series featuring actors and TV personalities. And now, from the world's number one TV after-show platform, this is AfterBuzz TV Spotlight On.
Okay. Guys, this is the greatest intro of all time for the music. We are listening to Lose Yourself with my full room of East Coast gems right now. I am here with the incredibly talented Emmy nominees, first-time Emmy nominees, Sharon Bialy and Sherry Thomas.
Yeah.
Hello.
We are so excited to have you guys. And of course, to my left, the amazing co-host, Ashley Daniels.
Hi, everyone. Hello.
I just blow kisses, blow kisses. I know, everybody's like, stop talking over my favorite song.
No,
is that really what you're thinking?
No.
What is this, what is the head bob that we do to it?
Oh, it's just the move. It's
okay.
Just to get into it.
It's the move. So there's a backstory to this song. We didn't just randomly pick it. What's the deal with this song?
This is a song that I listen to when we are going to what's called a test, when you're testing on a pilot, or anything, even if it's a screen test.
Mm-hmm.
I am a music person, and it's my time in the car where I still get to be in a club. Because I don't do that anymore.
The club,
and,
yep.
The club. I'm up in the club.
You
Toyota
can find
Benza.
In the club.
And I play it, and it gets me in the zone, and I get pumped for our actors. I get pumped for the process.
Great.
And yeah.
So that's incredible. I just want to introduce you guys a little bit and then let you talk about yourselves. But so we are sitting here with these casting directors. They're incredible. They've done all the shows that we even cover here at AfterBuzz TV. Breaking Bad, Walking Dead, Under the Dome, Halt and Catch Fire, Lie to Me, everything. You guys cover everything. You do more than just TV. Of course, you do all different things. You've had very long careers, and you guys work together as partners for almost 15 years, is it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I think that's just incredible, and we wanted to bring you guys in so you could talk more and shed light on the world of casting, which isn't getting the recognition it deserves all of the time. You know, the Emmys recognize casting directors, but a lot of other award shows don't. A lot of people don't know who the casting directors are or what the process looks like. So we wanted to bring you guys in to give you a chance to talk about what it is you do and all the incredible work you've done. So we really appreciate you guys coming in tonight.
That's awesome. We are so happy to be here. Thank
Great.
You. So awesome. Thank you.
We wanted to get a little background on you guys about where you're from and how it is that you guys joined forces. So we can start with you, Sharon. Can you give us a little info
sure.
on yourself?
I'm from Brooklyn, New York.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been out here quite a while. Let's see. How we joined forces or how we came into casting?
All the above. We have an hour to break down all of it, so we want to know all the nitty gritty.
My mother. No, sir. I grew up in New York, and I went to the second half of every Broadway show, not the first half, because my brother used to sneak us in at halftime.
Oh,
he called it halftime.
Genius.
I love it. Because we didn't have any money to go to the theater, so there were years where I saw the second half of A Chorus Line, Dreamgirls, mm-hmm. all the major things, you know, shows. And I fell in love with the world of acting through that. Went to college, came out here, and I was partners originally with Rick Fagano, and then we brought Debbie Manwiller in. It was, mm-hmm. it was a really great thing. We were doing theater, TV, and film, and I started in the theater. And had a couple of babies back to back, so kind of stepped back from running a really large company. And through Debbie Manwiller, I met Sherry Thomas because I was on my own and looking for someone to come work with me. You tell the story really well.
Well, it was for Mind of the Married Man,
right.
For Mike Binder, and
at
it had
HBO.
Been a longstanding mm-hmm. client of Sharon's, and I was looking to make a change. And there was a message on my voicemail that said, you know, I'm Sharon Bialy. I have a pilot. I, you know, would like to meet with you. And I didn't call her back right away. And then I called her the
You're
next day.
You're playing hard
day.
To get.
I wasn't playing hard to get. I was out and mm-hmm. was a little, you know,
yep.
out mm-hmm. for a while.
At the club, we could find you.
At the club mm-hmm. with
You were
the hair.
Yourself.
Yep. Yep. It was 14 years ago. Okay. So, you know, I called her and she said, I can't meet today. And I said, but I can come to you. Where do you want me to be? I can come to you right now. And Ma, Can you watch the kids? I got to meet Starbucks. Right. Her mother happened to be visiting. And so we met at Starbucks. We had an amazing meeting and, you know, talked about the project and really, it was brief, probably 20 minutes.
But I did tell her that I was supposed to meet some other people and I was done. I wanted to work with her.
Yeah.
And, you know, so, instinct.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
So what is our job that? Is.
Well, it's chemistry. I think it's the same thing that happens when you meet an actor. You know, there are certain actors who you have chemistry with, and there are certain actors you don't, but you still hire them, and it's kind of like dating. You know right away.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I just want to go back for a minute. So I understand. I want to know more of a backstory on you and how you got to LA. I know from what I read from you, it was kind of spontaneous. You had one trip with your girlfriends or something, and
It wasn't spontaneous. I kind of knew that I always wanted to live here, but I never knew why, because I hadn't been here. And okay. I grew up, you know, a lot of the kids do now, dancing and singing, and I really loved it. They do, and I'm sure you guys took your jazz tap and ballet classes.
Oh yeah, of course I did. Miracle.
And you drove here, correct? With a car with no air conditioning.
Correct. That's a Toyota Tercel 4-speed, vinyl seats, no air conditioning, and 150 bucks. Yep.
Oh my god.
And I just knew that I needed to be here, and I, you know, I had done a little research. I was working at the Gap at the time as a manager, and
perfect place to do
so
research.
So I used my 2-week vacation to know that I would have paychecks waiting for me, and then I kind of dropped here and then just started to figure it out.
What
and
about your family though? Were they like, okay, this is what you should do, you want to head west but you don't really know what you're doing?
Oh,
that's
god,
okay?
No, my dad was terrified.
Oh, of course.
And my stepmother as well. I mean, it was really, you know, hard for them to watch me go, but they knew that I needed to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And what's funny is when I was going to meet with Sharon, one of my favorite movies of all time was Rudy. And
oh my
so
gosh, that's my
going there, yeah, it was just really, you know, those things stick in your mind. So I had seen Rudy way before. And then when I got out here and some 5 or 7 years later after getting here, to get the call from her and then and to go, oh my God, she did Rudy. I'm going to meet the casting director of Rudy. This is so amazing.
Oh
and,
my God.
You know, among other greats, but that was the one that was really inspiring to me. So,
Sharon, why did you call her though? What were you looking for when you were sitting there? This is what I want. This is what I need to hire. I mean, were you just overwhelmed and you needed somebody else or?
Yeah, I definitely needed the support. I needed somebody else. Work was coming in and I needed, you know, help. And I didn't want to hire just an assistant.
Mm-hmm.
I think that it's a very collaborative art. So I was looking for, you know, the truth is I spend more time with Sherry and she probably spends more time with me than our family.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So you're really working together all day long. So you're interested in someone you want to hang out with, you want to have fun with, you respect and collaborate. And I sort of laid out, I think in that first meeting, my approach to casting. Mm-hmm. And it isn't always the same as other casting directors. You know, I love actors, and when they come into your audition room, they're scared and they're nervous, and I think they're coming into my home, and it's my job to make them relax.
And I agreed with that
and
whole
she really,
philosophy.
Right, had that philosophy.
And you voiced it to her.
Yeah, and I voiced it to her how much it is our job to make the actors feel as comfortable as they can, and then they'll do their best work, and to respect them. And so many actors have told us both so many stories of unpleasant casting situations, and I just don't live in that world. And
nor do I understand it.
Yeah,
because
yeah,
we
it's
need
weird.
Them.
It's such a misconception that actors have coming out here. A lot of casting director workshops, they instill to you that, you know, it's a place where you go, you have to be quiet, you know, you don't speak unless you're spoken to. Just they make you feel
like
so
you can't be yourself.
Afraid. I think that's why I did acting for 5 minutes. I was like,
right.
Screw this.
Yeah.
I'm too opinionated and I talk too much. They'll throw me right out.
Hence the hosting.
And it's so right, exactly. I know. But there's such a misconception because that's why you cast, that's why you are
who you are. Yeah.
Because
well,
you care what they feel like.
I do.
You're
I
get
care
the best
what
work
I care.
Them.
I want to, you know, part of it people say, "Oh, you're so nice." And I always say, "We're not that nice. We're just really smart. It's
right.
good business."
Yeah.
I mean, we have the actors doing their best work, not their worst work when
right.
they're coming
when
into
they come,
audition.
Mm-hmm.
So speaking about that, I wanted to talk a little bit about your audition process. So you both like to be in the room and you guys act as your own readers. Did I get that or how is it that
most
you
of
operate?
The time. Most of the time. That's why it's so tiring when you're acting all day long.
Right.
But we also have sometimes an assistant in the room. There's always somebody else, almost always somebody else in the room, so that there's two people. One's running the camera.
Right.
And one's reading. So it sort of works that way. And in our office, if your scene is with two people, and the both of us are reading. And most actors are used to just one casting director reading, you know, 3-4 roles.
They deepen their voice. They raise their voice.
Right. Or they
not
do
even. I mean, some don't even.
Some give you nothing. So, it's like a wall. Just
so
words.
We try to. We always, you know, one of the things we always notice that actors say, "Oh my God, that's awesome," is when we split the roles.
Really? So they have a point of reference.
Right. Is that fun for you guys at all, or is it just exhausting?
Oh, it's exhausting, but it's also really fun.
Well, actually, and that's why I wanted to know, because you kind of did acting for a little bit out here, right?
Were like a hot minute.
Yeah, so right, like me. But that hot minute, you were aware of your surroundings a lot more than a lot of other actors, in the sense that you were kind of feeling the energy between you and the casting directors and like the room. And is that how it kind of went?
I don't
for you?
Think I ever auditioned.
You
know
did.
What I mean? No, I took classes. No, I was actually pretty smart about that. Mm-hmm. I came out here and said, I actually want to be good and I want to do it right. I mm-hmm. didn't want to just jump into it,
right.
You know? So I took some classes and then, you know, you hear all of these different things coming from all different sources. And I don't know that it's necessarily the way that it should happen. I don't know that somebody should get off the plane or get out of their car and get headshots first and then try to get an agent without any education whatsoever or knowledge mm-hmm. of right. what a casting director is or does. Mm-hmm.
Well, I just Absolutely. Don't think there's one way to do it, you know, for somebody, this could be right, that could be right, you know, so when people say they have the answers to what, you know, this isn't the ladder that everybody has to climb.
Yeah, I also think it's different today than it was 15 years ago with reality television, and there are a lot of people that I think want to be famous as opposed to want to be artists.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's a very different
it's
thing.
It's totally different.
Absolutely.
And I just want to rewind really quickly so that we do get, I want to make sure we do get this answer, but what was the reason that you felt like you needed to move to LA? Was it something?
Right, because you are so interested in plays.
I stopped halfway across the country for 5-6 years. I went to school at University of Minnesota and I studied theater and dance and I got a degree.
They have an amazing program.
A really great program.
They do.
And I actually broke 3 fingers playing volleyball.
Oh my
so I
gosh.
Decided to be an actress, but I had, you know, taken. So I went to the Guthrie Theater and auditioned for a summer, their summer
rep. Yeah.
And I just lucked out because it was the great director, Romanian director Andrei Serban, and he had us do improv and movement. And I was like, I got that down. I can dance.
Yeah.
And I couldn't talk. And I got into the company.
Oh, wow.
And I spent one summer with probably 3 of the greatest theater directors of all time. And I looked around at all the other actors. Can you swear on the show?
Yeah. Absolutely.
And I was like, fuck, these people are good. And I knew I had to do something else.
Because
they were so talented. And I thought, I'm not that good.
It's so interesting that you are so self-aware of your level of I feel like there's many people
you kind of think, oh, I can do this. But when you're sitting in between, you know, two Broadway actors who become Broadway stars,
right.
Christine Rose, you know, David Warlow, Fred Applegate, and you listen to them, you go, fuck.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, I'm curious, though, because since you're from New York and you're so interested in theater and you did decide to become a casting director and you do love working in plays and all these things, mm-hmm. why Los Angeles then when New York is notorious for being the hotspot for Broadway and theater?
That's a great question. Well, I fell in love.
Oh, that
was
amazing. I did come out. I had been planning to come out here before that, but mm-hmm. that kind of helped solidify it. But my brother was out here. So I just wanted the adventure. I didn't want to go back to New York. I was from New York. I wanted to just do something different. And I loved the movies.
Right.
You know, I grew up, my mother watched the 4:30 movie. She was a school teacher. Almost every day after school.
I love that.
So I would sit and watch the 4:30 movie with her, and she would tell me who everybody was and who they were married to or sleeping with.
That's awesome.
That's amazing.
So if it was a really good movie, dinner was late.
Right.
So I fell in love with the movies, you know, and I thought this was the place to be if you were going to do movies.
So you both grew up loving, did you love TV growing
yes.
up? Is that what I was reading?
Oh,
okay.
Yes.
So you were like the kid in the Willy Wonka, the TV kid, well, mm-hmm. I forget his name, okay.
Yeah.
But see, it doesn't always turn out bad.
No, it really doesn't, and you know, I used to get really, really yelled at for it, and now, you know, today my dad is like, see, I told you that TV would pay
right.
off. I'm like, you ground me
like,
for watching too much TV.
Absolutely.
I wasn't a television watcher like that. I was totally a movie girl and theater, and
Isn't
even today I don't watch enough television.
That's the two best worlds, though. That's why you
both.
Yeah. And so, do you feel like your casting was different when you were solo casting versus together? Do you feel like there's just more magic that happens when you're collaborating with each other?
Well, for me personally, I was not
like,
at the level of of Sharon. I was working under her as her associate. Right. And then, you know, we worked together and then I became her business partner. And we can't say partner.
Yes, I know, I've specified.
Business partner.
Yes.
But, you know, what I will say is from the first minute that I walked in the door and I was working for her, it was different than any experience that I had had. Not that they were bad experiences before, because I think that you learn from everything. But it was just such an open and accessible place for me where I could say an idea and there was not an eye roll or no ideas, just put the calls out or whatever it was. And, you know, there had been some experiences of that prior. And so I had a lot of autonomy, which I had never had. And she let me really spread my wings and be a part of the process.
Here's a good story. As I went to New York for the casting on Mind of the Married Man for HBO. Mm-hmm. And I remember saying, Sherry, I'm going to New York. She goes, okay, what do I do?
I have 5 days of sessions set up for you.
I have 5 days of sessions for you, Sherry. Yeah. I said, well, you do them. She goes, but I said, I'm going to New York. You can handle it. You do the sessions and we'll talk at the end of every day.
Oh my gosh.
And she's like,
you were nervous or you excited or both?
It wasn't that I was nervous. I thought I knew every single person that was coming into the room because, you know, you're auditioning people at the series regular level. Yes. And so I thought, they're not going to fucking want to read for me. I'm just like, nothing, you know, and it's,
we call ourselves.
You just have to present yourself in a way that makes a difference. And, you know, after day one, I was like, I got this. Hey, yeah so.
Right.
The only thing I told her was, you cannot wear overalls to work.
I love overalls. I have to wear overalls. I don't care.
Speaking about how you present yourself, so I did want to talk a little bit. Of course, Sharon, you have your book out right now, How to Audition on Camera. And you do talk a lot about confidence in there. What do you find about confidence that makes it so important? You just think that when somebody walks in the room, you can smell it on them. And if they don't have it, then they're not right for the industry, or what is it about?
It doesn't mean you're not right for the industry, but it's weird. You can smell it. You can sense it, you know. And when you look, people get nervous, they're afraid, but if after the first or second take they can't relax, then it's a problem.
Yeah.
You know, and
absolutely.
And you do have to believe in yourself, and you do have to be confident. And it doesn't mean, you know, it's all about you, but you have to know what you're doing. And sometimes the confidence comes from being prepared, and a lot of actors aren't prepared.
And that translates to your guys' jobs as well. As you're saying, when somebody walks in the room, you have to be like, they want to be here to read for me, even though you were feeling
nervous.
But they
have to be prepared. Look, we have to audition for our work. We're not getting, you know, we don't always get offers.
No.
And we work our asses off before we go in for an interview. Right. I mean, we do our homework. We're doing our research. If it's a filmmaker, we'll watch all their movies. If it's a writer, we'll make sure we know everything about them.
Right. You know. So it's nerve-wracking for you guys as well. So you understand what it's like for an actor. So sometimes you feel like somebody won't be confident at first, but you know that if you give them a little more time, you can ease them in. Or just if you're not confident, then you don't get the role.
We always like to do a second take, and we always save the first takes for the 405.
Completely.
You know? Mm-hmm. And the second take's yours.
Amazing. So about your book a little more, though, I just wanted to say that I thought what was so amazing about it was how specific it was, which is so different than so many of these other books out there. I mean, you really talked about what to do in different situations. Like if you find yourself when you're reading an audition and you need to be fighting something or doing this, what do you do? What are the actions you make? So I thought that was really unique about your book, as opposed to we both read so many books. When you get out here, like you said, people tell you get your headshots, you read these.
That's,
so
yeah,
you know,
did,
you read books.
I did
books.
It the wrong way.
Yeah,
for sure.
I'm reading all these books, and I went to school out here for theater, so I'm reading all these different things, and I'm finding that your book was really specific. So I want you to give a chance to talk a little bit about it, so people who don't know it's out there are able to find it and see what you've done.
It's online. I collect signed books, and I wrote a book you can't sign. But I actually wrote it, probably wasn't the best motivation, but it was sort of revenge, because I went to a class at a very well-known theater school, and couldn't understand why they didn't have casting directors come in to teach an on-camera class. Mm-hmm. And the response was, well, we don't need to do that. One of our instructors wrote a book. And I thought, oh, great, I'll read it. And I read it that night. I went out and bought it and read it that night. And I was underlining and crossing things out, going, this isn't true. This is wrong. Right. This is not true. And I thought how unfair it was for someone to spend $200,000 on a college education and get out of school and not know how to interview for a job.
Mm-hmm.
I just thought, that's not right. And I thought, rather than, you know, I don't necessarily do the workshops. It's a thing I don't agree with, but I am a really good teacher and I believe in teaching. And I thought I can put it in a book. And instead of paying $35 to audition for a casting director, which I think is illegal, you could pay $5.99 and educate yourself.
Yes. Right, absolutely. So we can find
and it's very it was very rewarding because actors who have auditioned for years are the ones who have written me the most.
Really?
Saying, I wish I would have read mm-hmm. this book when I started. Mm-hmm. I made so many stupid mistakes. I am mortified, and it's still helping me today.
I'm really glad.
You're seeing people right now in your career, and you know, you're seeing people on a level that's, they're not beginning actors, correct?
No, we see a lot of beginning actors.
Oh, you do?
Actors.
Yes. Okay. Oh,
yeah,
you do.
Yeah, you have to find the next... Big thing.
I knew
yeah.
you were Breaking Bad in the sense that you didn't look for well-known names a lot of the times, right?
Never.
So that is so interesting because, you know, the stereotype would be to any actor, oh my gosh, I could never get in a room with Shannon or Sherry. Like, that's never going to happen. Like, but it can happen. So what are the key things that you, the key tools that you would say someone who is just starting out and is lucky enough to get in your room, what would you say? It's like three key factors that they really should keep in mind.
Be prepared. Number one, be prepared. Right. Know who, and it kind of goes hand in hand, I think, with know who you're coming in for.
Mm-hmm.
Know what the tone of the show is. Know
right.
what our aesthetic is in mm-hmm. a way. You know, you'll see based on who we cast sort of what our aesthetic is. And also be yourself. You know, I think that you have to understand what you're right and ready for. And if you read, I think if an actor reads something and they go, I don't get this at all, it's not them, they feel they're too old and they probably are, you know, whatever it is, then they can, you know, pass on it and say, I really don't think I'm right for this, mm-hmm. you know, and wait for a time when mm-hmm. when they are right.
I think the actors are probably so scared to do that because of actors, you
but
know,
that goes back to confidence, which is right. a lot what you talk about, and understanding, you know, that you know, 9 times out of 10, your first year out here, you're not going to book a series regular job.
Yeah.
Or the lead in a movie. You know, there are reasons that there are the steps to take and to educate right. yourself, I think.
But, you know, right. there are, I don't know how many millions of actors, so everyone can expect to get into our office. And we are very picky and we are mm-hmm. very selective. You know, we'll look at people's resumes really carefully. We'll get 1,800 submissions for one role mm-hmm. in Better Call Saul.
Mm-hmm.
One role,
and we go through every single one
you
of them.
You both go through everything together.
Well,
you
we'll split them up. Sometimes I'll say you take those three roles, I'll take
because you trust each other enough to make a decision.
We're kind of the one and the same at this point. But it's really fun when we fight over something. But not real fight, but just, you know, well, why don't you think they're right? Because I don't. And then...
What happens in that situation, though?
Yeah, paint a picture for us.
Well, we're partners, so at the end of the day,
I'll say, if you really believe they should come in, they should come in.
Right, and I say, if you really don't want them to come in, they won't, or vice versa, you know?
Of course. But we take a lot of thought into who we bring in, because you only have so many slots.
Right.
So when you get 1,800 submissions, and let's say you're bringing in 20,
mm-hmm.
those 20 you have to be really careful for, and most actors and even agents don't understand, well, I don't understand why you're not seeing my client. Well, because we were on the phone with the creator of the show, or in the case of Walking Dead and Better Call Saul, we can't tell you what it's really about. You have to trust us.
And
we know what they're looking for. And they're getting fake sides, dummy sides, so it's not the real scene. Right. They're not getting the real information.
And we have to shape it.
Yeah, it's a very interesting process because the actor really has to trust us.
Okay. It makes a lot of sense. You guys just mentioned a few specific shows, though, and I wanted to go and talk about because you guys have so many shows that people love. That people
especially
have.
AMC.
Yeah, on AMC, absolutely. Yeah. You guys have cult followings. Like, people watch these shows and they think that it's their life
well,
and their world.
Well, we're in
the
cult, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I love that.
We're Breaking Bad obsessed and, you know, Walking Dead obsessed.
Right. Yeah, and as are we. So
I don't know how you. I just have to say, like, when you were watching Breaking Bad, for instance, do you just feel every 2 seconds like, I did that.
Yeah.
Like,
no, you
no,
act. It's
you
actually
get lost.
You don't. It's so good you get lost in the show. But I have to say, having worked for as long as I've worked in the industry, oftentimes what you've read on the page and what you're imagined has not come to fruition on the screen. So one of the joys of Breaking Bad has been it's an amazing script,
mm-hmm.
but then it's the realization of it on screen far exceeds your own imagination.
Anything. Well, let's get
that's
into
incredible.
And it also incredible. A yeah. true testament to that was when we were putting together, we had to choose the scenes for right. the final Emmy reel.
Right.
And so I said, I'll do it. And it had to be from three specific episodes, no longer than 30 minutes. So we were going through the
We got
episodes
no
that
work
were
done
eligible. We got all nothing done.
How do you pick?
So right. you're, you know, and you're writing down the time codes, and you're trying to figure it out and time it right, and what scenes should be included. And I watched some scenes five times just to figure out, is that the right scene to go in? And you're just, you're riveted, and you're watching it as if it's the first time. Goosebumps. Gohar Ghazazian, who works in our office, peeking out from the computer, tears streaming right. down her face on one of the scenes. It was really magical.
Like, with the four of us share a bullpen. We all work together. Russell Scott, mm-hmm. Gohar Ghazazian, who are our casting directors, and the two of us. So we're all together. Literally, we're on the phone, and Russell and I are like this.
And you're just...
And they're talking to me on the phone. I'm going, huh, what? And I'm watching the scene
I've seen
five times.
It's incredible.
Yeah.
And you guys are fans of the show, but even if you were somebody who had never seen the show before, there are standalone episodes. Like, to me, we talk about this episode all the time, The Fly. We don't stop talking about that episode uh-huh. of television. Like,
The Fly comes in here a lot.
And we think that now, after we saw the episode, that there...
that you have a fly.
Yeah, that we have a fly.
Literally, every
one of
my Smiley Nons is a fly.
I'm, like, yeah, actually positive about it, but you guys are here now, so obviously The Fly isn't here. I don't know why. Yeah. But honestly, I think that...
Because we're The Fly.
No, because The Fly is afraid of you guys. You'll never cast that fly exactly. ever again. Yeah. But I think that it's amazing because you guys have created such incredible work, and I don't know how you would possibly pick those three moments to submit to them. Can you tell us about which moments you picked, or we're not allowed to know what you sent over?
No, I don't think so. I also wanted it to look really cool. So we started Mexican restaurant scene where it's the first time they all come together, Walt, Skyler, Marie, and Hank, and the waiter keeps coming over and interrupting them.
Yes. Yeah.
So we started with that. We did Walt and...
Jesse.
Yes. We ended with the blowout, with the shootout, which was a very, very long scene.
We didn't end on the baby?
But it was the only one from the episode. I wanted to end on him with the baby and then him going, Mama, the baby going, Mama, because it was so beautiful and poignant. But we ended with the blowout.
We ended with a bang.
That scene.
Yeah. It was really challenging. And
it was challenging also because... Look, the world is created by Vince Gilligan, and that's why it's so amazing. And then it's fully realized by all the artists that work with him, you know,
right.
the actors, the crew, the cinematography.
Right.
So for us, we were just looking for some of our favorite acting moments.
Of course.
Know? And those are hard to choose because there's so many.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because they did such an amazing job because you guys cast such an amazing show.
We had the stevia scene in there.
Oh, you did?
We did. Because you have to have Lydia.
Of course. Yeah, I know.
That was awesome.
Speaking
and
that of
was,
that
was
world.
Rewarding, though, because I think one of the reasons the show didn't get the recognition from the public the first four seasons.
This was awkward, yeah.
Is because we didn't cast stars.
It was very real.
It was very real.
Flashy.
And if anybody felt out of place, we were the first gatekeepers that wouldn't do it, and then Vince was the final, and then AMC and Sony.
Yeah.
So,
well, let's talk about that casting process, though. Yeah. So, I mean, obviously, this had to be a point of contention. You guys are taking the dad from Malcolm in the Middle, and you're moving him over to Breaking Bad. I mean, Bryan Cranston, how does that pop in your minds? How do you suggest him, and what do people say when you say, this is what we're going to do? You know, is everybody on your team?
Silence.
This is like so. Like, how did it even come in your head? In the first place?
Well, we do cast for theater. La Jolla Playhouse is a client of ours, and I had been working with Des Mackinac for 15 years, and we were casting. Aaron Sorkin wrote a new play called The Farnsworth Invention, so we were casting for that. And we, you know, Brian's agent called to say he wanted to do a play, and we were like, sure, let's try it. Okay. He came in red for a very, very difficult role, which was
and
very
he was unrecognizable. I said, Sharon, I don't know
who's the guy in the ways.
Oh, yeah. What she said. And I said, because he had sunglasses on, and he was just sitting there quietly in a suit.
Were they Walter White sunglasses?
They were not Walter White. Okay. They were very nice, and his hair was long.
No
he looked,
way.
He looked hot. Yeah. He looked really good.
He didn't recognize.
I did too.
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
And
that part was as far from Walter White correct. And Malcolm in the dad of Malcolm in the Middle as could be. And he, you know, you blew us away. You were in the room of a true talent.
Yeah, his levels. He could just go from this to that. I mean, a lot of actors, I feel, sometimes typecasting can be good for them. Like Jennifer Aniston always does love movies. Or like there's like character actors too that always play the same type of role. But then there's someone like this, which is, do you think if you chameleon. Didn't see him do this, that you would never know that he's like a chameleon?
Well, I think what would have happened with us, quite frankly, if we hadn't seen him in this audition, we approach a lot of things like this, is when it came down, if we had gotten the job, which, you know, hopefully it would have continued even if we didn't bring up his name to Vince in our audition, our meeting to get the job, that we would have had an open mind even then, because any smart agent read that script and said, what about? So let's just change the course that call came in for that. What about Bryan Cranston for Walter White? I think we both would have looked at each other and gone, that'd be fucking cool.
Yeah.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
So, you know, and that's
at least you know they think
often.
Outside the box, you
yeah.
know?
Yeah.
I mean, and Vince had worked with him on The X-Files, and everyone knows the story that Vince had him in mind already.
Right.
And people thought he was crazy. So I think it was the combination of us being able to passionately stand behind it. And we really believe in our instincts, and we have a lot of confidence in our projections.
Yeah, well, you have to in order to be
doing
what you do.
So I think, you know, that, you know, Sony stood behind us and AMC because, you know, we were a unified front. And let's be honest, it took a lot of balls for them to say
it. Really did.
It really did. I give them a lot of credit, both studio and network.
Is it coincidental at all that AMC has obviously rehired you, you know, you're doing another AMC, The Walking Dead, for instance?
Or Halt and Catch Fire, whatever.
Is it just...
Well, it's not coincidental because they like your work and they either recommend you or approve you.
Okay.
But your work speaks for itself, and I'm sure that the network wants to get it.
But you know what? It's interesting. We had met on a project that we got, and the filmmaker had said to us, you know, your work on Breaking Bad was fantastic, but if it had been just that show, I couldn't attribute it just to the casting director. But when I saw it on The Walking Dead and Breaking Bad, then I attribute a certain aspect
absolutely.
Of it to the
casting. Right. And I do.
Really, it was real. It was a really huge compliment.
I do agree.
It was.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. How do you even feel at that moment? What does that do to you? Is it just proud, like being proud, like very proud of yourselves?
Yeah.
Or is it like? Is it almost like?
It's kind of
like
because it's genuine.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you
for recognizing that.
It.
Well,
yeah.
Speaking of...
we take it seriously. We work our asses off.
I know you do.
Yeah, of course. But being acknowledged, I mean, you guys have gotten a huge acknowledgement this year. We have to mention it, of course, with your Emmy nom. Yeah. I mean,
woo!
So it's crazy to me because if you look at the actors on Breaking Bad, so many of them have been nominated that you would have to think that the casting directors would have been nominated. You know, I would just kind of assume. But you guys never have been. It's your first Emmy nom, and it's for Breaking Bad, and it's the last season. I mean, are you guys feeling just really, like she was saying, proud of this? Were you excited? Were you expecting the call? What was that like for you?
Wasn't expecting it. So excited and proud and all of the...
But damn
it's
right.
Funny. Most people have said it's about effing time.
Yeah.
And it kind of feels nice to hear that. And I don't know if we felt that, but it was like, okay.
I haven't had a carb in 35 days.
You look amazing, though.
Except for vodka. Yes, I had that. That doesn't count.
Literally... That's a vegetable, potato.
Why do you think it is? Why do casting directors, more often than not, you know, people don't really recognize their hard work.
Or
it's just
skipped
overlooked.
Over.
And why is it overlooked? Why is that when you are the
I don't know that we can answer that question.
I think it's a combination. I think there are certain directors who take all the credit for it. Oh, fuck it. I'll never work with Quentin Tarantino.
I love
that.
But
he stood up in public and, you know, never mentioned his casting director.
Right.
And I just can't believe he knew every single actor on his own.
Yeah.
So I think... You know, more and more directors and producers or writers are
acknowledging the contribution a casting director
Brian thanked us and everybody did this this last we really got a lot of shout outs from the people, and you know, Betsy Brandt day one has just every chance that she got really was very grateful and thankful, and they all were, but it just really sort of started to stand out in the last two seasons.
And sometimes the actors aren't aware of the process either. I have to be honest. Sometimes we'll hear an actor say, "Oh yeah, my agent got me that offer for the show,"
or the producer, knew me and got me the offer, and we kind of go,
What do they think? It just like skipped over you, or what are they?
But you know what it is. Everybody thinks they're a casting director. I think that's the hard part.
It's ignorance too.
But a lot of people we work with, they go, "Oh well, you know, I know who I like, etc." And one of our jobs is to know a lot of actors and the history of their work, so that when we say, "Well, what about," I don't know, you know. Aaron Paul, you're not just judging that one audition that the producer is seeing. You may have seen them multiple times in your room for different
perfect
jobs.
Example, Aaron Paul, when we were doing the pilot, his agent at the time, Amanda Glazer, called and said, "Well, what about Aaron Paul?" And we said, "God, we love him, but he feels like he might be a touch old at this point. But I don't know, he's so great." And she said, "Well, why don't you just try it? He's great." And I said, "He is great." She said, "He is great." And
and you guys had seen him for other things?
Mean, I think I was an assistant on Home Improvement. He may have gotten his SAG card on Home Improvement at that time, but I'm not sure.
Right. Okay.
But it was, he had two lines on Home Improvement.
Is that the Victoria?
No, that's when I worked for Deborah Barilsky.
Oh.
And he came in, and we were all just blown away, and we thought, it doesn't matter. Right. He's the guy.
Right. Well, I've seen you guys, you'll use actors in multiple things. The biggest one right now would be Dean Norris. Obviously, he went over from this to being
You also can't help it. It's not that. Well, I guess you do have your favorite actors, but if every time you bring in a certain actor, he makes the material sing and he's fantastic, why wouldn't you
continue to do it? Of course, I agree with that, but I was just wondering, what is it about some of the actors? The other one that I have is somebody who you guys had on the unit, and then she was on Lie to Me and then on Walking Dead, Audrey Marie Anderson. She came in did all three of those things for you.
Yeah.
So is it that you guys cast somebody and then maybe the director calls you and says they were amazing, like just so you know they were great on set, or somebody calls you and says it, or you guys just watch the show and you're like, "Wow, she killed it," and then she comes in and she auditions again and you're like, "Wow, she's killed. I'm just going to give
it." It's both. But see, she's booked those three shows for us, but we've seen her on probably every single one. So we also have the background of the other roles that she came in for that she didn't get, but just because she wasn't right for them.
Right.
So she's really talented and really layered, and the ones that she's very right for, she booked.
She books.
Right.
That's amazing.
At the end of the day, the producer is the one who's making the final choice of who you're presenting. And we're very vocal, and we try to be about what our choice is and why. You don't have to win. You don't have to agree. You just want to help educate and who you're working for and tell them why.
And there are some producers who really just want you to be a waitress of sorts. Right. And we use that very loosely, but it's, we bring them the casting director brings them the seven people that they really feel is right for the role, and they just they want to see seven more, or they want to see seven more, and that's called being a waitress, where there's really no collaboration. Mm-hmm. We have been fortunate enough to work with producers and directors and writers, quite frankly, who want us to be a part of it. They want our advice, they want our input. And honestly, if they don't, it's probably not the right fit for us.
Right. Of course. Right. And before, she mentioned that a lot of people can get typecast. And I've seen you guys talk before saying that sometimes you get typecast in things.
Yeah.
So I think that's really interesting, because since you guys come from such different backgrounds, and you were dancing and your musical theater and all these different things, and you've done commercials and film and television and have done comedies. So right now you guys seem to be doing a lot of dramas. You have so much stuff on air currently, and you are casting so many different things, and we'll talk about all those projects, but I just wonder, do you want to break out of that mold? What do you do to break out of that mold?
Well, we can't say everything on this show, but yes, we are going to break out of that mold.
Excitedly so.
Yes. Oh my god!
You got to
come back and share it with us when you
we're
can.
Really
we will.
Excited.
Okay. So projects that we can talk about though that you guys are working on.
Even in Breaking Bad, you'll see we put so many stand-up comics in. Which is so much fun, you know. And in movies, you know, Bill Burr, who we put in Breaking Bad, is also in the movie Black and White, which is going to premiere at the Toronto Film Festival.
Right.
With Kevin Costner and Octavia Spencer, and it's a dramatic role, and he's fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Oh, great. Mm-hmm. So you guys, because you're not getting these the casting director jobs for the comedies, then you're like, okay, screw it. We'll just take all the comedians anyway.
Well, the last one we did, I think, was, I don't remember what year it was, but it was the Victoria Pyle pilot. Didn't even have a name, and she created Smack the Pony in Green Wing in London, and she is probably the funniest woman I've ever met in my entire life. And it was such an amazing experience, and the hardest that we've ever worked. Ever.
Really?
Yes, because you're the whole thing is improv, and you have to be literally, you know, going toe to toe for 10 hours a day.
And because you guys are reading and you guys are acting
with
them.
It's also luck, you know, the same thing that happens with actors. Had that pilot gotten picked up and been successful, we would have been offered comedies.
Right.
But that didn't happen. But because the dramas we've done were successful, we've gotten more dramas. Mm-hmm. I started in movies, but now I'm a television casting director, so I don't get movies.
And in case you guys are just listening instead of watching, we're doing the bunny ear quotes over that.
Yeah. It's just something that the industry in Hollywood does to
everybody.
Not absolutely. Just actors, writers.
Okay. Yeah.
How important is... Okay, so... To get in your room, for instance, and someone has an agent that's very pushy, does that almost turn you off to an actor, or does their representation mean nothing if it's all a matter of that person, you know, when they walk in a room? Or do you ever feel like there's some agents or people that are knocking on your door saying, see my client, you're like, it's not the right fit. You can't say
they're
no.
Knocking on the door all the time.
How do you deal with that? Because you can't.
It's just part of the job.
And of course,
I make Gohar and Russell and Stacia pick up the phone.
No, it's just part of the process and what we have to do. And you know, we need them. We need them to bring us their new talent. We need them to introduce us to actors that we may not know, because they are the liaison between the actor community and us. And so. There are agents and managers that we have really great relationships with, and it's built on trust. When they say, you're going to love this person, totally your style of actor, you need to meet them, we say yes.
You have to do it because it's
But like, when somebody calls and they say, brilliant, 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 that's reserved for a very minor amount of people. And so... I don't trust somebody who says brilliant, brilliant, brilliant all the time, and they come in and might be just ready for, you know, a small co-star role or a couple of lines.
Right. And answer your question, it does make a difference who your agent and manager is. Because if we, you know, they have reputations and the same aesthetic that we do, and if there's a really differing aesthetic, it's not going to work.
So interesting what you just said, just with the trust too, just the fact that you know you may have worked with them over the years, you know that they're not going to send somebody in that's going to be completely, you know,
crap or whatever you want to say.
We have a reputation of being open, but I know the agents think we're really tough.
Well, of course.
It's good to keep it that way, though, just because they can use that to do me a favor.
We talked a little bit about people who come here and, you know, they get their headshots, and we also talked about the fact that you guys are looking for new talent all the time. So what do you say to people who did just come here and they've been here for a year or 2 years, whatever, they don't have representation, they see all of your show, they know all of your work, they think you guys are brilliant, and they hear about a project coming up that they think that they would be ripe for? Do they have a chance getting in your room? Do they have a chance of seeing you, or they just need to find a way to find representation? You know, how do you find your new talent? Is it only through that?
Honestly, it's tough because everybody thinks they're right for something.
Of course.
We get letters from all over the country and they all think they're right.
We get crashers.
Yeah, we get
get crashers?
Of course.
No.
Who think they're right for a role because they read it in a breakdown. And it's doing a disservice.
Of course.
How do you find out when they're crashers? After they've crashed?
Well, they're not on the session sheet.
Right,
and
but
we
still
ask
gotta...
the office and we say, does anybody know who this is? No.
So they never make it in.
Well, it depends on the day with our security guard.
Okay.
Depends on how hard they're crashing.
That's unbelievable.
Yeah.
Just to think, because I know so many people that have like crashed commercial auditions and then booked things.
Yeah,
somehow
it's not
like
a good idea in our world.
No,
but
No.
Especially because I do feel like we are very, very open to meeting a lot of new actors. And it is hard if you have absolutely no representation and anybody calling on your behalf. But there are other avenues. There's doing plays. You know, there with the internet right now, I mean, anybody can produce anything.
Do you guys look at all these YouTube or Vines or whatever it is?
Yeah, that's you have to, because that's sort of the wave of the future.
Right.
But we in our office, all four of us, you know, go to the theater. I think I drove everybody crazy and made them do that. But Sherry just went to a play last weekend, and I was in the session today, and like four of the people were from the play she'd seen.
Isn't that, see, that's amazing.
Equity Waiver.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So you told them afterward, you said, I've got this thing,
yeah,
I would love for you to come
audition.
Should
we bring back our programs and we all share what we've done on the weekend? You know, when you really love what you do like we do.
You don't really stop ever.
No.
Yeah. Amazing.
No.
Oh my
You're
gosh.
Passionate about it. Whatever you're watching on the weekend, you're, you know, and now mine's changed a little bit in terms of, you know, I have two toddlers, so I watch a lot of little kid TV. But every once in a while, you know, somebody is intriguing to me, and I go and I do my research and I find out who they are and what they're about, and
of course
share it with the, you know, with the office.
We have a staff meeting, not a formal one, but we get together, you know, sometimes we do formal ones, but we get together and we talk about, like, I saw this movie this weekend, did anybody see Boyhood, and I'll talk about the actors in that, and we'll add them to a database and look them up.
Yep,
absolutely.
Now your children, you have two daughters?
Yes.
Now they're how old?
2 and 3.
Oh my gosh, it's so. But no,
that's why she asked for a vodka when she came.
Right, exactly. I was gonna say that. I don't know how.
Oh
my gosh, you're like Wonder Woman.
This is time out. This is like a girls' night out.
Oh yeah, that's amazing how you do it all.
We need the champagne.
What would you? And you have?
I did it. I have two kids also. They were 13 months apart, but they're both graduated from college.
Okay, so now, have any of your kids ever asked to do acting? And would you ever allow your kids to do acting if they ever wanted to?
Great question.
You go first.
Luckily, my son did not. He's a journalist at CNN. I'm so proud of him. That's what he wanted to do. I think when you're a little kid and you've stepped over all the pictures and resumes in your mommy's office. And my daughter, for a little while, she's a jeweler, Michelle Berlinger. She started her own company.
I think you have some.
Wearing all her things.
Beautiful. Where can you get her jewelry?
MichelleBerlinger.com.
I love it.
Awesome.
She's really good, and she's actually styled some actresses recently.
Great.
So she wants to be in the fashion world.
She's an artist, a jewelry artist. But she did a commercial when she was younger because she was a gymnast, and they kept calling me, and I kept saying no. But then she went in and she got it. Uh-huh. And then with funny things, she goes, "Mommy, let's do another one."
And you're like, "I'm not driving you. I have a day job."
I love it.
But you know, I think they grew up and they love the movies, and they actually have a very good eye for good actors.
I bet they
do. Do they ever come to you? They ever come to you with somebody? Like, did you see this person in this? Because
they more share the movies they love or the actors they like. They love, you know, Brian and Aaron Paul, and you know, when they see something that we've done and they love an actor.
That's great.
My daughter called and said, "Mommy, I can't believe you cast Ryan." And I'm like,
"I know.
Who's Ryan?"
Because
Ryan from the OC.
That's amazing. You're like,
for Gotham, of course.
I was like, "Who's Ryan?" I didn't know. She meant like Ryan Ronan, who is an actor that I love that she also loves.
Oh, coolest moms ever, honestly. Yeah. And then now Ryan is one of your daughters.
Yes, she's going to be 4 in September.
I love the names. What was your daughter's name?
Andy.
I love those names.
Thank you. Thank you. And would I let them do it? No. I mean, here's the thing. I don't have time to drive them around. It's sort of the same thing. Like, yeah, it's true. And it's also, it's just a really tainted world if you can't be there every second of the day. And I feel like kids need to be kids. And look, if they're begging me one day, then they can do community theater like everybody else does. And then they can go to college if that's what they choose to do. And then if they want to work professionally after that, then they can do that. But you know, right now, it's just going to be fun in the house and let them do their thing. But they don't even know what it is.
No, of course.
Are you guys auntie to each other's kids? You seem so close.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Actually, I'm just Shay Shay.
She's Shay Shay to my kids.
That's adorable. I love it.
Yes, she's Auntie Sharon.
That's perfect. Auntie Sharon. Okay, so I did want to talk about the highly anticipated Better Call Saul.
Can't wait. I'm like...
Yeah, no, I know. So you just mentioned Gotham, which we can get into more, but we've got Better Call Saul, which you guys, what process are you going through right now? Have you finished casting? I mean, there were some people that
there's
already
so
had to be cast.
So little we can say. Yeah. We are towards the end?
Towards the end.
Middle.
Yeah, we have a few more episodes.
All right. We have like four more to go.
Yeah. And to cast, how many episodes do you have to cast?
The first season is 10.
You like have to cast them all ahead of time.
Well, you do the pilot.
Yeah.
And then in this situation, they went directly the next day from the pilot to the series.
Right.
Wow.
Well, because it's already so reputable.
You didn't have a stop, you know.
Right. So no break for you guys.
No.
It's okay.
Yeah. You would rather that? You guys love being as busy as you are?
Yes. Yes.
So I guess the answer is
it varies on the project. Yes. Okay. I will work on Better Call Saul till midnight if it requires it.
Got it.
Do you have to bring in the leads? Like, for instance, with Cranston when you had Walter White and Skylar, for instance, like, do you cast Walter White first and then you look for his wife and you have to bring him in all the time to see if they have that camaraderie? Is it same?
No, they just read, they, in that situation, Brian read with the contenders at the studio test.
Okay.
And the same thing on Better Call Saul, Bob Odenkirk read with the women that we tested for.
Okay.
You know, the leading lady role.
Got it.
So you could find someone who's great, but then you see them together and it just doesn't work. That can sometimes happen.
Yeah.
Oh, it makes your life more difficult.
They don't have the relationship, then they don't have the chemistry.
But there's so many times where you don't do that and the chemistry does work.
Really?
Oh, that's great then. I want to talk about all your future projects. So we have Better Call Saul, which we can't hear anything about, which is totally fine.
It's awesome.
I'm sure it is.
We're gonna cover
everybody.
It here, obviously,
everybody will watch it regardless. Like, it could.
And here's
could
the thing:
no
I think
ads.
If people have the expectation that it's going to be the funny, haha, Bob Odenkirk show, they'll be disappointed. I think if they go in with knowing that it's going to have the same aesthetic and brilliant writing, and you know, Peter Gould and Vince and. It's so, they think everything through so beautifully,
clearly,
carefully, and detailed that those people will love it. It's smart.
Right.
And funny. Mm-hmm. And, you know, look, we've been working on Vince's material for now, it's what, 6-7 years?
Yeah.
We're surprised in the scripts.
Oh,
like,
gosh,
we turn
a
page
wait.
And we go, what?
Mm-hmm.
It's so.
We have to wait so long.
It's so nice. No. It's worth the wait.
But you guys are working on other projects too, so we are working on Gotham. So we've got Ryan on Gotham. And how can you guys talk about how far you are in that process? Or no, we can't.
Yeah. I mean, that's pretty much out there. And we are on episode 6 of 16. And it's shooting in New York City, and we're really proud of it. We're very excited for it. We've seen the pilot. Have you guys seen the pilot? Do you guys get things early?
We have access to some things, but maybe I have it.
I'm SAG. I don't know if that does matter.
No.
I get sent.
No. It's more like the studio would give it to me.
But
no, I haven't seen it.
I get sent things.
It's really great.
And it's also a continuation of some of the kind of casting that we're the most proud of.
Yeah.
Wow.
Unknown people who will not be unknown after it airs. Mm-hmm.
That's amazing.
Wasn't there something with the Batman?
Yeah, I know we have to say. So one of our producers here was freaking out because we didn't know this story about Jaden Smith, Will Smith's son, who I guess he's dying to be in Gotham, guys. He keeps saying it, and his mom keeps plugging for him. So I guess he keeps saying, Mom, can you get me on this show? So Phil was like, did you see that? I was like, well, put in the good word for him.
We'll see what we can do.
And then the other show, did I get this right? The Battle Creek? It's a spinoff kind of the CSI kind of thing.
Well, Vince Gilligan wrote the script 12 years ago, I think.
Wow.
Oh, my God.
And so Josh Duhamel.
Right. And then CBS picked it up last year. And David Shore, who did House, is running the show. He's amazing.
Oh, incredible.
And it stars Josh Duhamel and Dean Winters and Janet McTeer.
Great. And you guys are working on so
Cal
many things.
Cal Penn.
How do you guys keep it straight then?
I don't know how you're doing it.
Well, we don't do them all at the same time.
It just seems like that's
what's
us.
What's in production.
Yeah. Us on IMDb. Look how many people are in production.
But some of them are all done.
Yeah, that's true.
It just kind of works out. And there's 4 of us in the office.
Okay.
You know, there's 2 of us. And honestly, a casting director can't survive on one show and live in Los Angeles.
Financially.
So you have to do multiples. And we actually turn a lot down because we feel we have to give the client 100%.
You'll get offers to cast shows
and
you say...
we just can't... we're not a factory, and we can't work. Mm-hmm. And if we can't give the kind of attention it deserves, we won't do it.
And course. Artistically, too, it might not be something right. that we have right. just gelled to. And, you know, and we're, because we put 150% into it. So if we can't put that in or don't want to.
Right. Just like you said yeah. with the actors, if they feel like it doesn't fit them, they should just yeah. turn it down.
Right. Like the yeah. AMC has a new pilot. It's fantastic. We would have loved to do it, but just, you know, yeah. our attention right now has to be on the people we're working with.
Of course, mm-hmm. of course. Mm-hmm. That's why you create such great
when,
work.
When like you see dead. 54 people for a waiter, you know that you need to make sure you're going to give Vince and Peter their time.
54 people. So you, so
for a waiter?
So you do the small, like a role that has maybe three lines. You don't cover that. Would you do something like that too?
It depends. Like if it was like it depends on the role. We
really?
Yeah.
And you'll actually
we have a fabulous casting director yes. in New Mexico, Kira.
Who's nominated
with us. Yes. Kira Rai, who does the location casting. So most of the time, due to budget, she'll do the
supporting roles.
Is she going to come out here?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
That's great. Completely incredible. You guys yeah. must be all knowing what you're wearing and excited to go.
No, oh, yeah. You are for 35 days. Right?
Yeah. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. What do we get to preview? What are we in? Some beautiful gowns?
No, well, we're not given anything. Let's just start there. Yes. So it all comes out of our own pocket
right. yeah.
and our own wallet, but that's okay.
I mean, it's worth it.
I spent more on this than I did on my wedding.
I was going to say, stylists
dress.
Would die.
Oh not my God. Wedding, my wedding
no,
dress.
No, the stylists don't want to dress us.
Oh, really?
Well, first of all, we're behind the scenes.
I can't get over that because I just think that... I mean, my fingers are so crossed for you guys this year. They really are.
Wait, I have to tell you the funniest thing. So, can I say, you know, I've said, you know, I'm so happy we finally got nominated. I'm so happy we finally got nominated. People say that. And Sherry comes to me the other day and she goes, you know what? I really want to win.
You know what?
You will. Something
I
you do.
In the other office. I closed the door. I said, I need to talk to you. And she said, what? And I said, I just have to say this. I have to say it out loud. I really want to win.
Yeah,
you know
of
what?
Course.
I honestly,
which isn't the
I
way.
I see it happening.
I'm very excited. And if we don't, it's fine. But how do you not get nominated for something and not want to win?
Yeah.
And everybody is like, oh, it's BS.
Well, it's all BS. You yeah. know, they're all lying. Of course you want to. Right.
Of course you do. And you guys are nominated alongside a lot of very talented
really
people.
Talented.
It's absolutely
so
true.
And our friends, some yeah. of them, we're very friendly with.
Of course. And it's not that you want them to lose. You just want to win. So.
Yeah. And then party.
So it's kind of, yeah.
And then party.
It's amazing. So I just briefly want to say you have multiple other shows on air, though. So we have Halt and Catch Fire.
Yes.
How has it been working on that show? So we're,
oh, it was great.
It's
it was
familiar
so smart,
to you guys.
Amazing scripts. Just a really terrific atmosphere. Very nice people. Such an amazing cast.
People here love that show. We cover it at AfterBuzz, and everybody's like obsessed with that show and also obsessed with Under the Dome, which is one of your guys' other show. I just binged it on Netflix.
She did.
I'm like freaking out obsessed about it.
No,
like,
I'm gonna do it.
Completely obsessed. So you guys have so many shows on.
I can't believe we don't work. Well, we did the pilot of Under the Dome, but we didn't do the series.
Right.
It's under a dome. You know, and they shoot there. And then when they came back the second season, we helped with a couple of series regulars, but we don't work on it during the year. So,
right, of course. But still, the process of picking the entire
Absolutely.
First lot
yeah.
of people
yeah,
it was
completely
great, insane.
That's why... There's the illusion, oh, they're doing this, and this. And no, we did that, you know, a year ago.
And also, people feel that we get multiple offers. This last project that, you know, we're taking on that we can't disclose.
Yes.
We went after it.
It was, yes.
Oh,
I saw it in the trades and said, we got to do this. And, you know, did my homework. And we reached out and we had the meeting last week. And it was, you know, everything paid off.
Yeah. So we can't know what it is, but you guys got it. Well, we hope.
So they say.
I can't wait.
Oh, my fingers are just crossed for you guys.
You're happy coming back. You have to.
Oh.
And you have to divulge everything.
I know.
Now we're just going to be waiting the whole time.
Yeah.
I told you I'm nosy.
Cool.
I have to know everything.
She is.
I'm sorry.
But that's why I love you as my host. You're so nosy and amazing. It's all good questions. So before we guys wrap, I just wanted to get a couple things from you. So I saw that you have this book, of course, and you have two more books coming out. Is the deal? Or?
Yes. But
I don't know how
you say that on air. The publisher's angry at me. I don't. Oh. I said I have a day job. Give me a break. I'll get to it.
My lips just yelled.
But
okay.
I love to write. I'm a closet writer. I would love to continue to help educate people and really help them. So I will get to it.
Okay.
Would you ever actually write a book together? Or is there anything like, just on your experiences and the
stories?
No,
because what I want to write about is completely different.
Yeah,
right.
I have the other book I'm going to write, but that's when I'm retiring because I'll never work again.
Is the book you want to write like an Eminem bio or something?
Maybe.
I mean,
want to read your book.
I gotta know what it is. Okay, so what other things can we plug of you guys? You guys have so many shows that we've talked about, and everybody knows where to find your work, of course. But any other projects you have going on that we didn't touch on that you guys wanted to speak about?
Or anything at all that we...
Or anything at all.
Anything.
No, they want
to
win.
Shout out to our staff. Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah.
It's not just us.
We're so blessed. We have our great. We changed our name from Bialy Thomas Casting to Bialy Thomas and Associates in honor of Russell Scott and Gohar Ghazazian, who are amazing casting directors in their own right. And we have an amazing assistant, Stacia Kimler, who
dealt with all of our emails.
And amazing. Just nonstop.
Yeah. I love her. Yeah.
And we have another assistant that we're waiting to bring back who is also awesome. Oh, Alyssa Moore. So, you know,
I love that.
As Mark Johnson said to me, you will never be a good producer. And I said, why? He goes, because you're sharing credit. It isn't just us on our own. You know, we collaborate a lot. I think that's part of the reason the work is good. You know, we sit in the office and we talk to Russell and Gohar, and we talk about why this person is right or why they aren't right.
Amazing.
So that the people who are coming in we thought it. We don't just throw it up against the wall and see what sticks.
Oh, you can see it. You can see it in your work. We can see that you guys thought through every single decision you made, and that's why we love it so much. Mm-hmm. I want to give you guys a chance to, if you're on social media, to tell everybody where they can find you so that they can keep up with you.
I know how to tweet now.
I'm very impressed. We have looked at you guys' Twitter. You guys are really good on the Twitter game.
We looked at your Twitter. I sound so dirty. I looked at your Twitter.
I don't know how to do Instagram, but I know how to tweet.
So where can everybody find you guys, though? What's
my handle?
Yes.
At Sharon Bialy?
Was that a question mark?
It's a question mark.
I'm pretty sure that's it. Right. And where can we find you, Sherry?
At Sherry Thomas _ST.
Great.
Was it
ST?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
And we're all questioning each other. And where can we find you, my love?
I don't know.
Where do we find you?
Daniels on Twitter and Instagram.
And you can find me everywhere at Roxy Stryer. And of course, you can keep watching their incredible shows. Thank you guys so much for listening to this amazing interview.
Thank you.
We bow down. We bow down. Thank you guys. And we will talk to you next time.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Some of them are very... Some of them are very...
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.